plans to talk about medical treatments of AKI complications with these things. So hyperkalemia, hopefully there'll be stuff here that is slightly different from what you know already. So teaching people about the management of hyperkalemia is a little bit silly perhaps, but it is obviously, well, we see it done badly all the time, so it's worth going over it again. Judging volume status, fluid therapy, I know you've already had at least one talk on that, dealing with metabolic acidosis and some of the other derangements. And this business here, I think, is increasingly important. You know, what to do as medics after an acute kidney injury episode has resolved, who needs to be followed up by a nephrologist, what does it mean if someone's had acute kidney injury, all that kind of stuff. So obviously it goes without saying, but hyperkalemia is serious and can be life-threatening. So we get calls about it all the time, obviously. I can kind of hear the surprise in referrers' voices when there are times when a nephrologist will say, oh, that's fine, don't worry about that, it's only 6.5. And other times when you've done what? When was the last insulin dextrose? When was the last potassium? So there are kind of different perceptions about when hyperkalemia is important and when it isn't. So any acute rise, someone who's not used to, doesn't have CKD, isn't used to running potassiums of 6 to 6.5, those are the people that we worry about, obviously. If they already have evidence of cardiac arrhythmia, and if someone is oliguric or anuric, the potassium is just going to rise and rise and rise. So you know that if you don't deal with it immediately, then you're going to be in trouble. So those are the situations where we get sort of a little bit more worked up. And again, I mean, this is something that I'm sure all of you do know, but the number of times that we're involved with cases of AKI where only the first two steps are done is pretty phenomenal. So this is from the Renal Association now has guidelines for management of hyperkalemia. I can give you the link at the end. And it's something that if you go back to your trusts, see what clinical guidelines you have back at work for hyperkalemia, and if they don't match up, then it's worth kind of flagging that up and adopting that are missing, because it really is the best practice these days. So removing potassium from the body isn't well done, monitoring after treatment isn't well done, and thinking about preventing recurrence as well. So we're talking about medical therapy AKI complications, and I've found out from the others what their backgrounds are, if I could.
So I'm a key medical consultant of Ward 3, who have this in the nation.
Oh, right, okay, sorry, faculty, yeah. Okay, yeah, sorry, yeah, sorry, yeah.
Thanks.
Good to meet you.
Hi.
I haven't put it up so you kind of can see all the details, but this is the algorithm in the Renal Association's new guidelines from earlier this year. Like I said, do take it back to your own work and see if how it compares with what you have in place. And it kind of forces you to do some stuff here that like I say, isn't generally well done. So watching out for hypoglycemia after giving insulin dextrose, when to recheck and all that kind of stuff, and giving calcium more than once. This is the kind of the scariest scenario that you really don't want to be confronted with. And when I was kind of updating these slides, there must be a million of these around these days. That's what we're aiming for. So this is from the same guidelines. And this is what we're all taught, isn't it? That there are kind of all these ECG changes associated with hyperkalemia. But starting with 10 to T weight, you can see here, and also forming of the QRS complex. But actually, ECG changes are really insensitive and non-specific. So this is a really good study here that looked at 90 admissions to a single hospital in the US with hyperkalemia, 90 consecutive admissions. They focused on T cell, sorry, T wave changes, and looking at different quintiles of potassiums. In fact, it's still only a minority of people, even at the highest end of the potassium, who actually have those tensor T waves. So you can have really seriously life-threatening hyperkalemia without having ECG changes. If you've got the ECG changes, it does make you, and especially important in the KRS complex and stuff, it does make you take it more seriously, but you don't wait for the ECG changes before doing it. So one of the things that I think is done badly is not giving enough calcium. It only lasts, its effect on protecting the myocardium is only very short-lived. If there are ECG changes, then repeating the ECG to assess the response and repeating the calcium until the QRS complex narrows is the right way to do it properly. If you give calcium gluconate, that's far less calcium than calcium chloride. In most cases, peripherally, outside the cardiac arrest setting, you would be using calcium gluconate, so it's worth remembering that. ECG, cardiac monitoring, especially if there's a sort of bradycardia at the outset, is really important. Obviously, someone with hypokalemia, you'd hope to be using cardiac monitoring anyway. Its effects will run out in less than an hour. So until you've got the potassium down, until you're sure that you've got the fact that the potassium down, you need to repeat it. So that's the first step, protecting the heart. Shifting potassium into cells is next. So again, you do know this stuff, I'm sure, but this is a collection of a number of papers looking at how much insulin dextrose brings potassium down, when its peak onset is, and how long it can last. Not all that helpful in this table, because the key thing is actually that it tends not to last more than, despite all it says here, at least kind of what we always teach is that it doesn't last more than 6 hours, or it doesn't reliably last more than 6 hours. So you will need to recheck and repeat. So you could just give glucose to someone who has an intact pancreas, who isn't diabetic, and their pancreas will produce just the right amount of insulin, obviously, if they've got appropriate glucose tolerance to be able to deal with that glucose. It's the insulin that's doing the work. But in most places, the protocol is to combine insulin with glucose. But again, the number of times that we see hypoglycemia complicating treatment of hyperkalemia is quite shocking. One of the things that I'm sure some of you have experienced, if you phone a nephrologist, you can almost predict that the answer is going to involve bicarb. So so we do. I don't know if it was mentioned this morning in the fluids or anything like that, but yeah, no, we like to develop bicarb. So the key thing is that if there is any acidosis present, then you're not going to be able to treat the hyperkalemia without correcting the acidosis. 1.26% bicarb is the isotonic version that you use. If there's volume depletion and you're going to be giving fluids anyway, then include bicarb in your fluid regime. Are you aware of this calcium business? Does it make sense to you? So if you think about the sort of the opposite, what happens when you hyperventilate, you become alkalotic with a respiratory alkalosis. That increases the binding of calcium to albumin, so your ionized calcium goes down, and that's why you become tetanic when you hyperventilate, because actually the free calcium is less. So conversely, because that ionized calcium is so tightly regulated, if someone is acidotic, they will have just the right amount of ionized calcium for that pH. But if you then correct that pH, the calcium will bind albumin and they will become tetanic. So that's what he's watching out for. And I mean, it's crazy that we love bicarb so much, but then at the same time, we also hate loading people with salt. That's what we're doing when we give sodium bicarb, so people with heart failure and stuff like that. It's worth bearing that in mind.
How do you use it? I mean, what kind of feeding?
Absolutely. So so it comes in 500ml tubes, and you give it as any other crystalloid. You wouldn't be using it at, you know, where you might give normal saline of a litre over 2 hours in, you know, to resuscitate. So you, yeah, exactly, yeah. And if you're giving someone fluids and you obviously include bicarb in that, you would say make it 1 litre of that crystalloid, sodium bicarb, and then the remaining 2 litres saline, something like that. So continuous bicarb is going to give you trouble. And so this bit is often missed out, or at least the only bit that's done is prescribing calcium prazonium. I'm yet to see a nephrologist prescribe calcium prazonium, to be honest. So it is overused. And it's kind of slightly shockingly, it's overused on surgical wards where the risk of complications is the greatest and causing intestinal necrosis. And again, I mean, this may be stuff that you're familiar with already, but at least the nephrological kind of mantra is that it's partly the prazonium that does it, but also the laxatives that you give at the same time that probably helps bring the potassium down so much. So if you really wanted to, you could just give someone loads and loads of laxatives, you'd probably have the same effect. So yeah, we tend not to use it. In someone who's peeing, using furosemide is a really good way of getting them into negative potassium balance. I mean, we know of it as an annoying side effect of the loop diuretics, right? The hypovolemia. But if you give them IV furosemide, and this is probably the only instance where giving furosemide and fluids at the same time makes sense. So you're forcing them to pee fluid that contains potassium, giving them fluid that doesn't, and they'll be, you know, within a day, they'll be in day or two, they'll be in significant negative potassium balance. Has anyone seen the use of fluticasone to treat hypokalemia? So that's one of the things that we do sometimes suggest. So the problem with it would be significant fluid salt retention. But it's very, a single dose of 50 micrograms is really potent. Combining that with furosemide, promoting a significant potassium loss through your kidneys. Only works if you're peeing. And if you're not, then it's that.
And what about salbutamol?
Yeah, no, thanks for asking about that. So salbutamol actually is in the guidelines. So to be able to bring someone's potassium down significantly with salbutamol, you need 20 milligrams of salbutamol. Do you use it much?
Occasionally, it's a holding measure to get the answer.
Yeah, absolutely. So at best, it's a holding measure. To me, it doesn't make any sense to give both salbutamol and insulin dextrose because they're acting on the same sodium-potassium ATPase. If you're giving the insulin, then presumably you're kind of saturating that mechanism. You can't shove any more potassium into cells. And you just get the problems associated with the, you know, tachycardias and stuff like that. So it is there in the renal association guidelines. At most, I think it should be used while the insulin dextrose is being drawn up, but no more than that. And I mean, the stuff that doesn't get done is sounds crazy, but the stuff that doesn't get done is stopping ACE inhibitor and spinal myotonia. Not only that, but then if this is on the, not really in the AKI setting, but on the wards or in primary care or in the outpatient setting, chronic hypokalemia, you kind of think about stuff like beta blockers and heparin, which do contribute to potassium potential. So I'm kind of glossing over what you were mentioning earlier as being one of your key questions with AKI, and partly because it's not possible, not easy to kind of say in AKI you need to give 3 litres in 24 hours. So the real, you know, and you would have had already a talk on fluids in AKI, and there are endless debates about which fluids, how much, how quickly, and like I say, now's not the time to give you definitive answers on that. But I think when AKI management goes wrong is when too much or too little is given, but also there isn't the appropriate monitoring and monitoring and reassessment. So giving people fluid for AKI, if they're oliguric or not, is a sort of dynamic measurement in a sense as well. So thinking about it as a fluid challenge. and reassessing where you get to, not writing up 24 hours worth of fluids and then checking the creatinine the next day and realizing that nothing's changed and the patient's overloaded. That's exactly the wrong way to be managing AKI. And there's more and more awareness of the harms caused by fluid overload. So this is from the review article that I think was mentioned just earlier, written by some faculty members, of the specific harms of fluid overload within the kidney as well, actually, in causing edema within the kidney and propagating AKI within the kidney itself. So the dangers of fluid overload becoming increasingly recognised. This is in the context of not so much, you know, for an acute medicine ward audience, I suppose. This is all in the context of acute lung injury as well. But this kind of goes against most of the stuff that we were aware of when I think we were training, that liberal fluid management actually does a lot of harm. So a positive fluid balance in critically ill patients associated with increased mortality. And in fact, you know, it kind of does go against what we were kind of brought up on. Higher doses of furosemide in this study were associated with improved mortality. So it's a difficult take-home message, really, that we see all the time AKI because people are dry, but it really does need to be thought through carefully and reassessed at regular intervals. Fluid overload with AKI, it's like managing any other pulmonary edema, I suppose, but that's worth just spelling that out. Dosing furosemide in patients with AKI, what would you? Yeah, you see that given quite a lot. And I suppose it's a useful starting point, 40 or 80 probably, but then if someone has pre-existing chronic kidney disease, it's unlikely to touch them. So if you are treating significant volume overload in someone with a background of chronic kidney disease who's been tipped over, then anything less than 250 or something like that would be such a patient. So that's managing hypokalemia. Hopefully there was some stuff there, like I say, that was more than what you have in your minds already, stuff that's done badly. The next complication of AKI that you're worth talking about is just to mention correcting the metabolic acidosis, and I mean, I've spoken about it a little bit already. So again, you know, you'll hear us at the end of the phone advising, giving bicarb quite a bit. So it can be very useful, but it is to a certain, you know, it's not dealing with the underlying problem. You need to diagnose what the metabolic acidosis is about. What's the cause of the metabolic acidosis? And it's particularly useful if you're already giving someone crystalloids and they're acidotic, because they have lots of diarrhea or whatever, then it's worth using it. Particular cases of AKI. Forms of AKI where bicarb is particularly useful, or rhabdomyolysis particularly is one of those, because alkalinizing the urine to increase the solubility of myoglobin is part of the aim. And if you're unsure about using it, then do discuss with nephrology or critical care. I think we probably use it more than critical care people do, and there is debate about it, because, you know, just in one way, it kind of just makes numbers better. Whether it actually changes outcomes, who knows? And I mentioned the risk of precipitating tetany through reducing ionized calcium. And people with a background of respiratory disease and difficulty in blowing off their carbon dioxide, you can make things worse. So type 2 respiratory failure is best avoided. Just to mention some of the other things that you would be dealing with when dealing with AKI in a phosphate arrangement, so a low calcium and a high phosphate. Another kind of take-home message is it's really important to correct the hypocalcemia, or at least think about the hypocalcemia before correcting the acidosis, for the same reason that I was talking about. So if you if someone is hypocalcemic, as they may be in lots of cases of AKI, if you correct the acidosis, then you will make that worse first and provoke tetany and cardiac arrhythmias that way. So controlling the calcium and phosphate derangements, again, is something that we would be happy to be involved with, but it may include phosphate binders, typically calcium-containing phosphate binders in this situation, and alpha-calcinol as well. The other thing to be aware of, the smaller print stuff in managing this, is that if someone's phosphate is very high and you give them lots of calcium suddenly, the really high phosphates and really low calciums often happen in rhabdomyolysis, you can cause precipitation of calcium and cause problems. So it's best to correct hypocalcemia gently in that setting. People with AKI are at increased risk of bleeding, so it's important to bear that in mind when admitting people with AKI. I've seen them on the wards. When you think about their thromboprophylaxis and how to dose their low-grade heparin, it's best to give anyone with AKI some form of gastric protection, whether that's a PPI or an NSAID. And there needs to be very good reasons why people should be continuing on their antiplatelet agents if they have AKI. And people with AKI who do bleed, whether it's from GI bleed or elsewhere, then DDADP is the first thing to go to. But be aware of causing hypoglycemia. And so then other bits, the stuff that good care that keeps people with AKI alive. Thinking about nutrition early, it's something that we've got better at generally, I think, in all unloved patients. Specialist dietitian input, which will help with controlling potassium. Identifying and treating sepsis, that's what kills people with AKI if it's not the metabolic derangements. And having a really careful look at stopping all the nephrotoxins, which again is not done very well. And thinking about, again, we see this on the wards all the time, people who have developed AKI as an inpatient with blood pressures running in the hundreds or so nothing too shocking, but a low blood pressure for that patient, and still on all that antihypertensives. Just to mention at the end of this bit, I'm sure you'll be hearing loads over today and tomorrow about the long-term consequences of AKI and how AKI is, or seems to be, for reasons that aren't fully understood, a really important risk factor for future cardiovascular risk. As has been mentioned already today, again, much of this. So that's becoming increasingly clear. And there are some places that now have set up AKI clinics to follow up people who have had AKI, even AKI that's returned back to its baseline. And I don't know, Taryn, if you have views on it, but I'm not convinced that we know what those clinics are meant to be doing, other than saying, yes, you're at increased cardiovascular risk. But maybe
there's also a risk of increased risk of getting end-stage renal disease if you have AKI. In fact, you've got more risk as an inpatient of getting, if you had AKI as an inpatient, of ending up with end-stage than if you're an inpatient with plain CKD.
Yeah.
So I think, some of the clinics are there to just measure creatinine, see what the baseline is. For some people, you might think their creatinine's come back to baseline, but if they've been critically ill, their flesh weight is reduced, so actually their creatinine might actually be worse than it was. So I don't think other than getting those criteria where they are, then saying to GPs, although this is not CKD, you should monitor this person as CKD. I think that's probably the benefit at the moment, until we have more information.
Yeah, and so it's worth being aware of that connection, and as Taryn says, the risk that AKI confers not only on cardiovascular risk but on developing CKD further down the line. And again, it's something that we see. One of the things that I think is done badly with AKI is not arranging that follow-up, not seeing that creatinine that's got back to its baseline, not connecting with a nephrologist or with a GP to say, we've stopped all these medicines, please have a think about them again in the future. That really is a key part of closing the loop with AKI. and there's another bit that isn't yet on the guidelines of who to refer for AKI, but actually, you know, I'm sure very few nephrologists or no nephrologists would be upset if AKI had been managed perfectly and then they get a call at the end saying, we've done all of this, what should we do next? So I think that's another key, as far as I'm concerned, that's a really key thing to do.
I had someone who works in nephrology and general medicine. Mm. I think what's done really badly is AKI is resolved, lots else going on, is that destroys somebody with that connection with the GP, saying, be aware of this patient, and making sure that the GP knows to follow them up. Just keep an eye on that.
Any questions on this?